Hi, good evening. Welcome to the Dare Act Conversation Series. We're going to be joined by our guest today, Garima. Give us a moment while we add her, please. Garima, I've sent you the invite. Ah, there you are. Hello.
You look gorgeous today.
Hi, thank you. And so are you. How are you?
Oh, it's going good. It's going good. I have been waiting for your call.
Super. Okay, for those of us who don't know enough about Garima, Garima is a lawyer. She's qualified from the Bombay University here. In fact, we have a common alma mater. We both went to Government Law College in Bombay. After which she practiced IP laws and then decided that she wanted to pursue far more exciting opportunities, and we'll learn more about that shortly. But we'll straight get to it, Garima, with you. So why did you choose to practice the law, and what was college life like?
So I think like most of the Indian families, we did not know anything apart from engineering and medicine.
Sure.
So the fact that I hated science in school, I was a disaster at it. I quit science in 10th standard. So
okay.
Junior college, I took up commerce. So engineering and medicine was out of the question.
Sure.
Then after doing commerce for 2 years, I realized I hate accounting as well. So the next in line is chartered accountancy. That was out. Absolutely out. So now I was absolutely confused. I had no idea what to do. Hotel management was always on the cards. But then, you know, because of lack of, I would say, career counseling, we did not know anything about it. The only thing we knew that the working hours are pretty odd. You may have a night shift. You may get done at 2 o'clock in the night. And it's a male-dominated line.
Right.
Now when I'm talking, it sounds like law quite a lot. But
yeah.
That's why I did not pursue hotel management. So one day my father comes back home and he met with another friend of his. And his daughter and I have been childhood friends, and she's been brilliant. She has been academically brilliant, very smart kid. She had a great influence on me, even in my childhood. So he told me that she's been preparing for CLAT for the past 2 years. And, you know, it's a great course. It's 5 years law course. I mean, 2 degrees in one, you save 1 year. Sounds great. And to my mind, I think, yeah, that sounds good. We can do that. And then, you know, that added that, you know, that pinch of salt that you get that you fight a lot, you argue a lot, and probably you'll do great as a lawyer. That's what you have to do. I said, yeah, that sounds really good. I mean, something that people have always told me that you get angry too fast, that will be as a profession. I said, yeah, that works great.
Yeah.
And
it's actually absolutely the opposite, right? So it's such a massive myth that to make a good lawyer, you actually have to be a bit impulsive and angry and sort of, you know, argue extensively. But that's absolutely untrue.
You have to be very, very calm. You have to be so calm that nothing...
That's logical, even in an argument.
Exactly. I think most of us...
It is real, so I hear you.
I was absolutely sold that, yeah, if it's not engineering, if it's not medicine, let's just do law. That's what I want to do. And CLAT was a disaster because preparing for 2 months, you will not do anything well, anything great. Don't even expect anything out of it. For us, I think I was really lucky that we had GLC and ILS for us. And the only times I've studied in my life is 2 years in my junior college, which is 11th and 12th standard. I scored fairly well.
Correct.
Yes, it was easier for us to get in because of Maharashtra State Board. Not in GLC, ILS it was easier to get in. So we both have that in common as well, 15 days of ILS and then moving to GLC.
Yes, and the horror that we now call Sharda Niketan.
Yeah, that's a conversation for another day. But GLC happened. There was this bumper list, the 17th or the 18th list. I was in ILS. It was already 10 days that I was in ILS, and I have always been longing for a hostel life, but my parents just brought me back that you're going to study in GLC. So that's how GLC happened. And when I came to GLC, I was already late. The session had started. People had already made friends. And I was like, again, I was a lost puppy. I was looking here and there. What do I do? Not understanding much. And the committees had begun their interviews and people were already enrolling in. All of that was happening.
The MCA committee. There were the more privileged committees, and then there were the slightly less privileged committees. Someone made it to the less privileged committees, but the more privileged ones were already, full up.
That place, I think it was funny because I was in all the committees. You name it and I was in it. There was no committee. I think I was part of 13 committees in my first year.
So that's a lot to juggle. Did you study and pass the first year, or you quit that part completely?
That's actually really funny because, when you enter GLC, the first thing that you hear even before entering GLC is that GLC people are very, very villa in life because they have no lectures. So all they do is staff around, they chill in college, they do their committee work, and that's all they do. They don't study at all. When we entered college, the first thing that was told to us was, placements are not going to be easy. They'll be very difficult. Bear that in mind. And that comes as a shocker. You come to an institution thinking after 5 years, you'll get this fancy job. You'll be a hotshot lawyer. And the first thing that's told to you by your seniors is, job nahi milegi. So then that scares you a lot.
Right.
So then, and obviously the general consensus is start interning. Everybody starts interning.
True.
Now, as we discussed earlier also, I am someone who runs away from the herd mentality. If everybody is interning, everybody is doing moots, everybody is doing MUNs, I will not do that.
You're not going to do it.
Yes. And something, you understand some things by talking to people and general interactions, that if you don't have a godfather in the industry, it's difficult for you to get a good job or a good placement. And of course, when seniors are telling you that you're not going to get a job. So I took a step back and I reevaluated, what should I do that by the end of 5 years, I get a job. I don't care what job it is. I need a job. That is it. So my 5 years were pretty unconventional. I did a couple of moots. Most of them were internal. Only one was that external moot court. And I realized that I am good at mooting, but I also realized that I don't like it. I just don't like it. I did not understand the point of investing 4 or 5 months of your life into just 3 or 4 or 5 propositions of law. And in the end, the moot could just go bizarre.
Correct.
Like the first moot that I did outside of college, I had no idea what happened. In the end, we got that moot blacklisted. But okay, so my point was that the 5 months that I invested, right, what happened? I felt betrayed. I felt that my hard work has gone nowhere. Tried modern interventions, and for me, the topic of international politics, it just goes tangent to my brain. I had nothing to say. I was in the
girl who now lives in different countries every 2-3 years.
Maybe now I'll be better at it. And also because I'm married a guy who is all about reading the news, he does not leave anything. So maybe now I know better. But back then there were times where I attended Model United Nations and I did not utter a single word. So then I was
of course. It's only fair. I think sitting in Churchgate, there's a very little worldview you can have on what's happening maybe between South Korea and North Korea, right? So now sitting in South Korea, I'm sure you have a view on a lot of things. But again, maybe that's a conversation for another day. So that's one interesting part that we want to know. Why is it that a lot of your batchmates, and in fact, incidentally, a lot of seniors in the profession also, refer to you as Dawn? What is that about?
Okay, all right. So that's actually a very funny story. In my junior college, I was like a dada. The only times I've studied in my life is my junior college, 11th and 12th in Maharashtra State Board. And since I was a very good student, I was topping and I secured some great scores even at university level. Okay. So I had this stand over everything that was going on in college. Like, I was not a representative, but I was still a representative. So I shifted the practical dates and I used to, if I'm bored, I would just go to have lunch with my teachers and HODs in the staff room, and all the other kids would wonder, what is going on? Why is this girl sitting with the maths HOD and having lunch with her? So, I had a very good rapport with my maths professor. And she was the one, I can see one of the comments of my very close friends from college. So she said that this girl is like Dawn. Nobody can touch her. She's just walking around in college and, throwing her weight off on other people. So that's how she gave me the name Dawn. And then there was a wave in GLC where everybody put a middle name on Facebook. So I think there was Amrita Workaholic Vyas. I don't know if Amrita is here, but so people have done those things. I had no idea what should I put. I didn't know how to describe myself. I remember Dawn, so I put in Dawn. And that Dawn, I think that just stuck around. It's been there forever now. Even, I remember I was in Kathawala's court. I was with my managing partner and I was waiting behind him for a matter. And one of my seniors, he comes, "Dawn, Dawn, come here, Dawn." And, "Don't call me that. Don't." And I was making all facial expressions that I could without uttering a word that "don't call me that" in front of my boss. "Please don't call me that." Of course, he heard it because, these guys are so observant. Even a pin falls, they'll know. So
Correct.
after some days, he's asking me that, "Why was that guy calling you Don?" So then I had to explain
The
something to him. He laughed.
context.
Yeah, even a couple of people told me that now you are in the profession, you should remove it from Facebook. And my point was, why should I? Like, let it be.
It's
it's not
part of
gonna
who
harm me.
yeah, and it's part of who my college identity was, right? So absolutely own it. I get that. Nice.
I just got rid of it. It's still there. It's still there. And even now, when someone calls me Garima, it's so weird because it's Dawn. Guys, it's Dawn.
Wow, you're really owning that tag. Okay, so you clearly enjoyed college and you found a way to sort of land that job that we spoke of. Now after that, actually, you have the unique experience of working with a really small size boutique firm. Then you went on to a mid-sized firm and then you worked with a tier one firm as well. Clearly very, very different infrastructures and ecosystems in place. Tell us a little bit about what skills you may have picked up at these three different sort of diverse workplaces, or what were the experiences like at each of them?
Okay. When we talk about skills, I don't have a clear-cut answer to that because I don't know how good of a lawyer I was really in those 5 years that I worked as a lawyer. But some life skills that I picked up, I realized was that I'm a very good manager. I am a better manager than I am an employee. So I could make interns do all my work. Obviously, my seniors did not know that, but I had like a band of interns under me because, and they used to think that, yeah, this girl is pretty chill. And we can report to her and she's gonna be chill about work. So I used to make all the interns work for me. Nobody knew about this. They were doing all my work.
Oh,
I was teaching them. It was a very healthy relationship. They were happy. I was happy. My work is getting done. They are getting to learn. And they were very happy with the entire experience of working at a small law firm. And deadlines were being met, so nobody had a problem, and I became everyone's favorite, and that was great. So I realized that about myself. I'm a great manager, and I can just get the work done. And even in court, I could go to departments and get the work done. I never faced a problem. The biggest problem that I had was I did not speak Marathi, but I could still go to court and get the work done. And it was one of my fortes, and my firm also recognized it. Ki problem hai, isko bhej do, ye kara degi, ho jayega. And my boss used to love me for that. And I also loved it because I used to go there, get yelled at left, right, and center. All the ladies would be like in Marathi, da, 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 they would go on for with their rant. And then, I also used to trigger them a little more that, "Madam, Marathi to aati nahi hai, aapne jo bola samajh hi nahi aaya." So then they would go again for 10 more minutes. So but I used to get the work done. I was a go-getter.
So what I'm hearing more of, I think, just being able to build a connect across it was probably agnostic, in terms of who the audience was, right from office staff to your interns to probably your managing
Correct.
partner. So
Correct.
networking really is a skill that probably comes naturally and must have been honed at the workplace, I assume.
I think that is something that all of us need to learn because you cannot have the same kind of behavior with everybody, with your managing partner or your boss or your senior or your juniors or people at court or even the helping staff in office. You have to speak their language and you need to know how to get the work done. Because if you just go and tell them, ki, please do this, they will not care about you at all.
Correct.
You have to, somewhere you have to nag them, somewhere you have to be polite, somewhere you have to, you know, work your charm and make them do your work. So that is something that you need to work. You need to understand that.
Sure, fair. Okay.
Then again, the second skill set is not a positive skill set, I think I would say. And that happened because of the odd working hours that we had in law firms, was that when you're working and you have to sit in office till 10 o'clock in the night, irrespective of your work being done or not, I became extremely lazy. I mean, I used to start working only after lunch. So I made it a point that I come to office, I just surf the internet, I waste my time, but pretend to be busy, pretend to be really busy with work, and then go for lunch, go for our afternoon stroll and come back and then start the work. Because this is something I did not like, because if you give me the motivation of getting done with my work by 6 p.m. and then I get to leave at 6 p.m. and do whatever I want, I'll be very efficient. But with the working culture that we have presently in firm, that, and more in the tier one law firms, is that if you leave before 10 p.m. in the night, oh, you're not good enough, you're not good, hardworking enough. So when you know that you have to sit till 10 p.m. in the night, and on that particular day you don't have enough work, what do you do? I would start really late. I would start post lunch, and that made me very, very lazy. It is a trait that I picked up. Not happy about it, but yeah, that did happen.
True. No, of course, there are aspects to your personality that will creep in, which you don't necessarily enjoy, but they become part of the experience. So fair enough. So tell us, what was that moment after having worked across these three types of firms that we spoke of? Was there something that sort of particularly stood out, any major takeaways in terms of what works better and what doesn't?
I think I wouldn't call it what is better and what is not, because I am someone who comes from the school of thought that koi kaam chota nahi hota.
Sure.
Anything you do, everything you do, it's important. You play an important part in the entire ecosystem, and it's important to do that work. Agar tum nahi karoge, and if you're not there, honestly, the presence is, your absence is felt. That, you know, because the person is not there, work is stuck. What I realized about working in a small size firm, medium size firm, corporate, and a big size firm is that the kind of exposure you get is different. The kind of exposure you get in a small size firm is very varied. You get to do everything. I mean, in a small size firm, I think what matters is you need to build a trust with your employers. The more number of years you spend with them, even if there's a certain sort of compartmentalization, once they trust you that this person is here for the long haul and they're going to be there, they will trust you with everything, and you're exposed to almost everything they do. So that's a great kind of exposure that you get in a small firm. And I mean, money-wise, you get there. Don't worry about the money. You do get there. And again, one thing that I have to emphasize a lot on is that you do have a life after office. Even if you leave at 7, 8, 9, you don't have to worry. In a small-size firm, once you leave office, you've left office, office is back there, you are doing what you want to, and the only time you again start worrying about work is when you come back to work. In a mid-size firm, what I realized was that the compartmentalization is there, but it's informal. So although you are hired for a certain profile, that this is the kind of work you'll be doing, even then you still have a scope that you get to work on something that's not on your work profile or your job requirement. So then, if I am just there and another team needs someone to help them out and I am not a part of that team, just lend this person, lend your junior, and we'll just take their help. So that is something that I, in my mid-sized law firm, I was hired for prosecution work. But sometimes when court matters called for it, I used to get roped in, and I really enjoyed working on litigation matters.
Sure.
In corporate, what I realized was that you will not be working on a lot of law. You will not practice a lot of law. It's very managerial. It's a lot of managerial work. You will be doing the back-end work, and you'll be dealing with your people, your departments, the organizations department. So those are the people you'll be dealing
with.
Correct. The business vertical. Correct. And you'll be dealing with the law firms. And in my case, it was the firm I was working for. So that was really funny. I used to go sign affidavits for them. That was really funny. I was really on the other side. So But one thing about corporates that I want to point out, and I point that out to everyone, is that the growth in corporates is very slow. So if you want to join a corporate, please join it after some years. Because if you start at level zero and you want to come at a higher managerial position, it will take you maybe 10 years. And if you come from a legal law firm background and you've practiced for 6-7 years and you join a corporate, they'll value your experience. They'll give you a higher position and a higher salary. And that is, I think, true for every corporate. And then come the king of all, the tier one law firms. Everybody wants to work there. That's the dream. That's the Makkah Medina of any lawyer. Ki wahan kaam karna hai. Everybody has that one place. Honestly, I feel that if you go to a big law firm, you should understand the working culture. The working culture of all places is very different. Big law firms have a very, very compartmentalized working structure. Whatever you are hired for, that is exactly you will be doing. You don't have the scope of varying your practice. You would be doing that one thing that you've been hired for. It's impossible for you to go and work for another partner or a different team. And it's not that, it's not how it works. And also the crazy working hours. The working hours are absolutely crazy. You have to work for 15 hours a day. You need to have a solid 12-hour timesheet, which has billable. Most of the hours should be billable. And you have to do other things as well apart from your work. You have to write papers. You have to, what are those called? Presentations, internal presentations and all those things. And you have to work on the weekends. You have to sometimes carry work over your vacations. So, and there's a lot of pressure. It's not because it's made, I mean, I don't know how, why is it that it's made that way or the structure is such, but there is a lot of pressure. The amount of pressure when you compare to a small size, mid-sized corporate or a big law firm, the amount of pressure in a big law firm is immense. So my learning was that you should know yourself better first before getting into any firm. You should know what do you want, and then you should decide where are you getting at. Because if you get into something without knowing, so for me, tier one law firms are not for me. I cannot handle that pressure. I do not want to work like that. It's not for me. But honestly, you know, maybe I knew that, but I forgot in that moment because, you know, you worked in a small, mid-sized corporate. Now what's next? What's next? Our generation is very, very impatient. We want everything instantly. Abhi chahiye, abhi chahiye. So yeah, there's a thing. Let's apply. Let's do that. So it was very, the experience that I had was very varied. And I realized a lot of things about myself. I don't work great under pressure. Not at all.
And I think that comes from just constantly asking yourself the question, am I happy? Is this good for me? You know, and that's probably a very big takeaway, which you're not really spelling out. But I'm going to, you know, take that away from this conversation that when we constantly assess our strengths, our weaknesses, what we like, what we don't like, I think that's when we can make better, more informed decisions and then sometimes walk away from dream jobs, like you said.
Please complete yourself.
Yeah, so to want to pursue things that you don't even know whether are going to be, you know, entirely successful in the traditional sense of success.
Yeah, but you know, the major problem that we faced was in college when we discussed that where do you want to apply for a job. The only discussion was, kaun kitna paisa de raha hai? So the only thing that people would discuss, oh, this one pays this much, this one pays this much, this guy pays so much for article clerks also, they'll start paying you an associate salary in the third year. And so I signed my articles because, you know, I'm a lazy person. I knew that I cannot take up 1 month, 2 month internships and keep looking for internships. So I knew myself, I'm like, I can't do that. Let's just sign my articles, stay at a place for 3 years and learn on the job. I cannot be looking for internships. It's not my thing. So then the only discussion was, oh, you should sign your articles at this place. They pay a lot. Oh, no, you should sign your articles at this place. They'll absorb you. You should sign your articles at this place. Third year, they'll pay you as an associate. So, you know, these were the discussions. Nobody nobody spoke about the work culture. Nobody spoke about the amount of pressure you'll be in. Nobody spoke about that you'll be hammered with work and you'll have no personal life left. So nobody told us that. If I knew it, I wouldn't do it. And honestly, Panisha, I'll tell you that when we sat for placements towards the end of our third year for our articles, everybody was running behind tier one law firms. I had 10 options to give, I did not enter a single tier one law firm.
Tier one.
None. I just mentioned five, which were the mid-size and the small firms, because I maybe that time I was more aware of myself that this is not for me. Later, somewhere I just faded.
That's okay. I think you do, and then you know whether it works or not. So I guess it's part of that journey. Super. So moving away from all the law and the law firms, we want to know, when you actually moved out of India, you completely kissed the law goodbye, because it would mean requalifying, studying again. You were intending to anyway move countries every couple of years. So you chose to take on some really unique assignments. What is it that you did when you first moved out of India to Paris? What happened in Paris?
So, I think we were really fortunate enough to be living in Paris. My husband was already working there. He was there for almost 3 years before I moved to Paris, and I was there for 2 years. The first 6 months, I did not do anything. We were just the newly married, backpacking. My husband
in
loves
Paris.
To travel. Across Europe, not just Paris, across Europe. And, you know, France, my husband had some 55 leaves for the year, and they were, everybody was pushed to take them. It's not like India. It's like, no, you have to finish your leaves. Take all the leaves. Go on vacation. And the pressure in the office was that you're not going for a vacation. That was the pressure, not work. The pressure was you need to tell them that, yeah, I am traveling. So the first 6 months we traveled, I did not think of anything. I deserved that break probably after having been working for six years, maybe. Yeah, I needed that break. And then I landed upon an opening for a babysitting job. And even in France, like any other country, they prefer native American speaking people. But then I applied and I went to meet the family, and they liked me, I liked them, and they hired me. So I was babysitting these wonderful girls, 11 and 6 years old. Since they were old enough, I really had to do nothing. Sometimes I would just go with them and play with them. I they had a guitar at home. I play the guitar. I mean, I'm learning YouTube. I'm learning, you know, the advantages of not working. So I used to play the guitar, and one thing I realized, that French parenting is better than Indian parenting. We don't know how to raise kids. Very, very sorry. But yeah, they know it better. And the second important thing that the two girls were very, very passionate about YouTube. So they used to, we used to just sit and record videos, doing some conversation, something or the other. And then the elder one, the 11-year-old, would edit them over the weekend and then show it to me, saying that, oh, see, I made a video for YouTube. Of course, they were not allowed to post it because they were too young and their parents had not given them permission. But it's so funny that, you know, all your life you're looking for inspiration, and then suddenly I found my inspiration in those two kids, the 11 and the 6-year-old. That was my inspiration. And I was like, wow, I was just flabbergasted that, after being so worried about what is my future, what do I do in the future? And, you know, I find my inspiration in these two little kids. So the biggest learning that I had from that job was that don't stop looking for inspiration. You don't know how, you don't know when, you don't know what way it's going to come your way. And, you know, be open to it, be receptive to it, and just take it. Just take it as you get it. So that's what I did in Paris. And apart from that, I didn't do anything. I was just chilling. We were just traveling.
So you clearly have had like a massive interest and passion towards cooking and food. And then this exposure with these young French girls around YouTube and editing. And then you very intelligently sort of brought the two worlds together. And you now create some fantastic content on YouTube. Using audio, music, I'm not sure if music is the right word, but sounds really, which is autonomic sensory meridian responses that you actually activate through the sounds. And I've watched some of the videos, and for those watching or who will watch later, please head over to her YouTube channel and see how the chopping of the onion and the slicing of the meat sounds, because it's almost like there's a cathartic release. There's no doubt about that. So how did this come about? How did Headless Kitchen really come about? Because truly, there is no head, there is no audio, like a person talking. What is that about? How did this happen?
So for me, from the beginning, from college days, I've been cooking and I really enjoyed cooking. There have been some weird experiences where I got live crabs and they jumped out of my pot and they started running across the house and I did not know what to do. Lack of research. I did not know what to do with those crabs. So I've had some varied funny experiences, but I always knew that I enjoy this. These are my kind of challenges. Don't give me a second to research or give me live crabs and I'll figure out what to do with them. So
I like that. Okay.
People used to tell me that you should start a blog with your recipes. I used to cook over the weekends because cooking for me was a stress buster. I used to cook over the weekends to release my stress that I've accumulated over the week. So when I used to cook over the weekends and people said I have a blog never interested me because I don't like writing. You know, you have to be really precise when you write on blogs. I'm like, nah, not my thing. Then suddenly video blogging came into picture and there were so many people cooking and teaching how to cook on online. And again, there's a problem. I am a camera shy person. Right now, it's so difficult for me to ignore those comments down. I'm like, no, this is a call. This is a call. Don't think it's a
minute. You should do what I do. I have glasses. I don't wear them. I don't wear lenses. I can't read anything anyone is saying. So I'm compelled to tune out. There's a massive comment now, which I'm almost feeling compelled to read. But we'll read that later. Go on.
I wish. So I am a very camera shy person. If you tell me that come in front of the camera, I'll be like, but I can't. I'll be like that. I'll be like completely spastic. I can't function. And then again, the entire herd mentality thing, because the world is doing it, I will not do it. I need to do something different. It's like in my head. Kuch to alag karna hai. Ye to nahi karne wali. Main aisa. So then, when I was in we realized that we'll be moving to Korea around September 2020. And then I had 2 months and I was just on YouTube all the time looking at blogs and trying to understand what kind of place Korea is and, you know, Mulla ki daud masjid tak kya sabzi mil rahi hai, kya masale mil rahe hai. All of that was my perspective ki dekhe zara kya mil raha hai. So this is what I wanted to do. And because I was looking at a lot of Korean content, this was thrown on my feed by the YouTube algorithm. And I saw the videos and it's similar. It's something that's very similar. There's no face, there's nobody talking. And it's just the daily cooking life routine. And I saw that and I had a eureka moment that this is it. This is it, what I want to do, because it's fantastic. It's got all the food in it. You don't have to stick to one recipe. You don't have to teach anything, because I feel that teaching is it's a very noble thing to do. If I'm not an expert, I should not be teaching anything to anyone. The channel is all about me and my husband, our food adventures. We go eat something, then we try to recreate the same at home. And that is what the channel is about. There's nothing special. There's nothing professional about it. It's very, very regular, normal daily life stuff. Sure. And headless happened because I am not the creative one, to be honest. It's my husband who's the creative head behind all of this. And I have to really beat my head against the wall and try to come up with stuff. He does it naturally. So I asked him that I don't know what to call my channel. So he said, what are you going to do on your channel? I said, I'm not going to show my face, but I'm going to cook. So he said, okay, there's no head, so it's headless. And you know, headless chicken, but you do headless kitchen. And, wow, that sounds amazing. That's great. And that's how we coined it.
So talking about Korea and talking about, you know, all your food expeditions that we've been seeing on the channel, right now India is going through a phase, okay? And this entire pandemic, I feel like Indians have survived on newfound love for Korean food and for K-dramas, okay? So without...
K-pop, there's another sect that you're forgetting. There's K-pop and people have gone nuts about it.
I was just going to talk about Gangnam Style. And, you know, when I was researching Korea before this talk, I realized Gangnam Style was released in 2012. It's that old. But I can still sing it like top of my head. That is the impact it had. So, yeah, sure. K-pop is a big part too. So without wasting any more time, do you want to actually, since you're sitting in Seoul right now, and we've talked about all of this Korean food and, you know, my mouth is almost watering. So do you, and you're a cook, like a chef, and you enjoy it. So do you actually want to maybe show us like a quick Korean fun recipe?
I can do that. I can do that. I have in fact done the prep work for you. I knew that this is going to happen. So let's do the prep work and keep it ready. So
let's do this. Okay, super.
I'll just move to my kitchen.
Please.
Which is right next to me. See, that's the prep work.
So we've never done this on Dare Act before. We've never ever had any of our guests actually, you know.
Oh, maybe not. But anyway, no, okay, I'll just...
You may want to
tilt your
camera a bit.
So, what I'm going to make today is a Korean pancake. So, these are green onions. This is zucchini. This is carrot. This is potatoes.
Right.
These are mushrooms. And I have forgotten to do the onions, which I'll do now. I forgot to slice them.
Okay.
But, okay. So while we do that. Yeah. Yes, you can keep talking, don't worry. I'm trying to adjust the camera somehow. Maybe I'll fit. Yeah, there.
What is this called?
So this is, you can call it a Korean pancake. It's a pancake. And I think in Korean it's called, I forgot what it's
called.
Sorry.
That's okay. But it's a savory pancake. Savory, it's not sweet.
Yeah, it's a savory pancake. Generally, it's made vegetarian, and Koreans love to have it with their soju.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
And honestly, this recipe is especially for my dear friend, Mr. Amal Sethi. He messaged me some days back. Amal, yes, he messaged me some days back that. Why don't you make anything vegetarian on your show? And, because I think he's a vegetarian. So I told him, all right, I'm going to make something vegetarian just for you. This recipe just for Amal.
So Amal was also a guest with us on Dare Act a few months ago. And
the camera is not adjusting pretty well.
Don't worry about it.
Maybe I can just raise it to my level and I think it's better.
We can see you.
So all you have to do is you have to chop your vegetables. Korean cooking is a lot about colors. They emphasize a lot about colors. And I have taken 3/4 of a cup of all-purpose flour. That's the amount of flour that's there. Not a lot of flour. It's basically a lot of vegetables, not just flour. And generally you make it vegetarian, but there are also a lot of variations that people make out of this. You can add your favorite seafood, you can add octopus, snails, anything basically. It's a savory pancake, and your imagination can go wild with this. Don't worry. One thing that's very cool about Koreans is that when they're mixing things, they use a glove so that their hands don't get dirty. Isn't that cool?
Yeah, very cool. I'm Maharashtrian, so my clan will actually just use milk, you know, those pishwis where they're called milk bags, which Maharashtrians So maybe I can next time, use one of those as a glove. That's what I'm going to do.
And then this is the same amount of water as the flour. So you can see the bowl, it's full of vegetables now. There was barely any flour in it. And you add water, the same amount of water as your flour. And maybe some salt as per your taste.
Okay.
So
and will you be adding spices as well?
No spices. This is just this. That is it. Okay. So one thing that you should understand about Korean cooking is that it's very, very basic. You don't add a lot of additional things to it. And they have their set few spices. They have their gochujang and the gochugaru, which is basically their... the gochujang is the fermented red chili paste. And gochugaru is the same chili, but it's the dried pepper flakes.
Okay.
That's about
and then they have their soya bean, what we call in Japanese miso, is right. what they have here in Korea as well. But I think it's called something different. I'm not sure what it's called. Okay. My bad, I should have researched it. And so they make it, they use most of their cooking, most of their stews, most of their side dishes, what they call banchans. The base is that, just that. Okay. And Korean food is amazing. It has that distinct flavor despite not being very, very difficult to make.
Right.
And it still tastes brilliant. I think I was in Europe before this and my taste buds, they died. They literally died because spicy was a pinch of black pepper. Sorry. Can't do this.
Fair enough. Okay.
So yeah, this is mixed. This is your batter.
Okay.
It's a lot of ingredients, a little bit of maida, all-purpose flour.
Right.
And you do need a little bit of oil for this because it has to be crispy. If you don't add oil, it will not be crispy, then you will not like it, maybe.
Are you adding the batter or just from the pan that you're going
to do? No, I have taken my pan. I have heated my pan. I have added my oil to it. Now I'll add the pancake batter to it and I'll show you. Then I'll reverse the camera and show it to you.
Sure.
I'll make a small one right now and so that it cooks quickly.
Done. So while it's cooking, do you want to answer one other question for us?
Why not?
Okay, super. So clearly, you know, this is some absolute crazy act of bravery to move away from the law, to do what you've done and, you know, continue to do this. So you clearly have taken on very new and unexplored paths simply in the pursuit of happiness, it seems. Do you want to tell us a little bit about what that journey has felt like?
I think I was not brave in the beginning. You know, coming from a middle class family, you start earning a respectable salary and you're getting it every month. And you don't want to get rid of that. It's not that easy. Even if you're miserable at what you're doing, the thought of quitting your job, whatever job it is, and thinking that, okay, from next month, I will not have a salary. And I might not have anything to, have the money that I used to get. And I used to splurge on shopping and going out with my friends. I will not have that money. So I did not have that courage. Also, quitting law just happened. I mean, destiny has its own way of unfolding. I was not planning on quitting, honestly, but I got engaged and I got married and I had to move out of the country and I took a break. And that's when, I mean, I think I have to give a lot of credit to my husband because he is the one who thinks out of the box. He used to come home every day, almost like every second day, and with a new idea that, you know, you could do this, you could do that, you should do this, do something like that, do something like this. And he also loves to cook. He loves to cook. If I love to cook, he loves to cook the same intensity. So then he encouraged me a lot. It is obviously scary. It is. And I think for us, who come from the Indian society, the biggest fear that we have is log kya karenge. Because, arre, law padha, lekin practice nahi kiya, naukri chhod di, ab khana bana rahe hain YouTube pe. So then, you know, that thought is always there ki log kya karenge. And it does, you know, it does play a factor on your mind before you take any decision. But then again, you have to do what you have to do. When you have been uncertain and unhappy for such a long time and you need to take a call, you do it. You have to take that call. And then I will not lie. So I'll show you. I'll interrupt and I'll show you. I'm going to flip it now.
Oh, wow. This is yum.
It tastes great. It tastes great, I'm telling you. So then, It took some time for me to get used to it, that I will not be practicing law anymore and I'll be doing something else, and to get used to the whole idea of log kya kahenge. But then after one point of time, I had to tell myself that don't bother. Yes. Just don't bother. Because, you know, log to kehte hi rahenge. You do good or you do bad, people are always going to talk. So let's not hold us back because of that thought or what people are going to think. If they understand what you're doing to be happy, great. If they don't, great. I mean, I can't help it. I'm
absolutely
sorry.
Absolutely. You're happy. And I think you know, start that up really well. I think the only person we should feel accountable to is ourselves. So if one were to say live by that, I think...
Correct. You know, I became like Farhan Qureshi from Three Idiots. You know, when he goes to his Abba to explain that I want to do photography. Ki Abba ghar chota hoga, gaadi choti hogi, par main khush rahunga. I am Farhan Qureshi. Like, I'll be happy. Just let me be. It's all right. You know, people don't understand the concept of my channel. It's a very niche concept. Not many people will like it. So sure. They say that chakal to dikhani padegi, tumko bolna padega, tum bologe nahi to log kaise dekhenge tumhara channel. That's all right. It's a niche. If you like it, you watch it. If you don't like it, you don't watch it. I'll be talking to myself. This is the kind of content I enjoy, and if I'm being honest to my audience, I'll show what I enjoy. I get irritated when someone comes on camera and keeps talking, yeng, like, please shut up and show me what you're doing. I want to be honest to my audience.
Yeah, you've got to stay true to what works for you. Absolutely.
Correct. And if you're not honest to yourself, it will show in your work. You know, if you're too pretentious and you want to be someone you're not, it will show in your work.
It'll come through very quickly. Yeah.
In your life, do what you want to. Gaadi choti hogi, ghar chota hoga, but khush rahoge.
Correct. True. Golden words.
Absolutely. I stand by them. I believe them.
Right. So what is this pancake now looking like? I'm so curious. I'm peeping in as if I'm going to be able to see, okay? Like, it's the silliest thing anyone can do on camera, to try and peep into another kitchen via
camera. It's not yet done. I'll take another minute to do it and I'll show you the final result. And I'll tell you something.
What does it eat with? Like, what can Indians eat this with?
So this is actually a side dish. You can call it a breakfast food, but people eat it as a main course, a lunch and a dinner as well. So yeah, okay, let's do that. And while this is cooking, I'll have take 2 minutes and whip up a side dipping sauce for it.
Okay.
Let me do that. So okay, this is sesame oil.
Okay.
Very, very important for Korean cooking. So okay. You take approximately 1 spoon of sesame oil.
All right.
This is your regular soy sauce.
Mm-hmm.
Soy sauce. Just whatever you get in the market. Not the dark soy sauce, it gets too salty.
Okay.
And you add maybe one tablespoon of the soy sauce.
Right.
This is white vinegar. Okay. Any regular vinegar is fine. And again, 1 spoon of that. Then to balance out all the saltiness from these ingredients, I'm going to be using some sugar. You need some sugar in your Korean cooking. Okay. I'll add some sugar to it. And so this is what I was talking about. This is gochugaru, which is the Korean red chili flakes.
Dry,
not the paste.
It's the dry powder.
Yes. And you can ignore it if you don't find it. It's okay.
But sesame tell me, if we're making this in an Indian kitchen, would like a peri peri or regular red chili powder or just chili flake be a good substitute?
Yes, I think it will. Yeah, it will. If you have regular chili flakes, use that. Because as long as it tastes good, it doesn't matter what you're adding.
Correct.
And you're able to get good Korean ingredients. Oh yeah, one tip I'll give you that when you use sesame oil, don't use the regular sesame oil. Make sure it's the toasted one. Because the regular sesame oil has no taste in it. And if you use it in Korean cooking, it's not going to give you that flavor.
Understood.
So you need to use the toasted
sesame
one.
Sesame has to be toasted, followed. Okay.
Yes, absolutely. So yeah, my dipping sauce is ready. This is what it looks like. I don't know if you can see it. Can you see
it? A little bit we can. Tilt the bowl a bit.
I will turn the camera and show it to you. Okay, I think the pancake is ready.
Oh, yay. Okay.
I'm going to take it out of the plate. It doesn't have a beautiful color on it yet. It has to be a little more brown. But because of the paucity of time, I'm not doing that.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, we've got about 5 minutes before this live ends. So yeah, you're right.
Yeah, this is your pancake.
That looks so good.
It is delicious.
Yeah, I can tell.
Oh, this is your dipping sauce.
Dipping sauce, sure. Oh, wow.
And it
That simple, Avik. It's super simple. And this is especially
amazing.
For my vegetarian friends, all my vegetarian friends, because, you know, my channel is all about non-vegetarian food. I think I'll deprive all my vegetarian friends. I overcompensate by telling them, come home, I'll feed you with vegetarian Korean food.
Sure.
But it doesn't happen on my channel. Because see, again, it doesn't come to me honestly.
I was just going to say, I think coming home to you right now would mean coming to South Korea, which is a bit unlikely. So you stick to doing more vegetarian on the channel, please. I'm vegetarian and I have vested interest that you do more recipes like the one you did today. Thank you. That was a lot of fun.
I'll have to do that.
Definitely deep in Sherry Shroff because she's obsessed with Korean food and dramas.
Absolutely do that. I love to talk to anybody who's obsessed with Korea.
We should definitely tag her later when we reshare this video. I'm going to do it. Okay, Grey Matter is going to do it. Okay, one very quick last question in the interest of time. You'll have to probably answer this a little more swiftly. What is the one advice you'd like to give law students or even legal professionals who aren't sure of, you know, if they don't enjoy the practice? Just any advice for somebody feeling stuck?
I think give it your best shot. If you're still not able to like it, it's not a crime. Talking in legal terms, koi crime nahi hai that you've studied law and you have to practice it. Anything that you've studied, if you're not liking it, you don't have to practice it. YOLO, zindagi ek hi hai, be happy. Don't think about लोग क्या कहेंगे if I leave it, because you know जो लोग कहेंगे कि शर्मा जी के बेटे ने लॉ कर लिया वो ही बात करेंगे कि शर्मा जी का बेटा पागल भी हो गया because काम पसंद नहीं आया. So it is not worth it. No job is worth it. No money is worth it if you're not liking it and if it's bothering you. This is your life. Dictate the terms. It doesn't matter if people don't understand it. If these are the terms on which you want to be happy, just be happy and don't be afraid to take a break. Don't be afraid, because sometimes you get so taxed in your own mind that even to get a fresh inspiration to do something new, you don't have that frame of mind.
Right.
Just take a break. Don't do anything. And trust me, you will find something. If you don't have an inspiration already, some people have something to fall back on. They have music, they have art, they have something or the else they already know. For someone like me, I didn't know anything. Sirf khana banana aata tha. तो उसी पे सोच लिया. बट वेन आई टुक अ ब्रेक आई डिडंट हैव दैट इन माइंड. आई डिड नॉट नो. एंड द अदर थिंग इज डोंट बी अफ्रेड ऑफ फेलियर. इफ यू स्टार्ट समथिंग न्यू, इफ यू आर गुड एट इट, इफ इट वर्क्स ग्रेट, इफ इट डजंट सो व्हाट. एट द मोस्ट यू लर्न सम न्यू स्किल सेट्स दैट आर गोना हेल्प यू समवेयर इन द फ्यूचर. इट डजंट मैटर इफ इट डजंट वर्क आउट. आई मीन इट्स ऑल राइट, हु केयर्स. जस्ट डू समथिंग न्यू अंटिल अनलेस यू फाइंड योरसेल्फ. And for people who are confused, I think they should follow the Direct series. I think you guys are doing a wonderful job. If I had that during the times when I was confused, I would have, you know, been much more confident of doing something like this, because people are confused. They don't know. They are living in this pretense world where, you know, lawyers are like, yeah, we have a great job. We are happy. We are dying, but we are happy. So you don't know what is going on really in the world. And if I would have heard stories before that there are people like me who were not happy with what they were doing and now they're doing something else and that makes them happy, I would have loved it. Like till today, you know, I work till 2 o'clock in the night sometimes because my video is not done, but I love it. I am happy. I love it. I enjoy it. I can do so many other things. I'm learning the guitar. I'm learning the tabla. I'm doing so many other things and working some days till 2 o'clock in the night, but I'm happy. It doesn't matter if it's giving me money or not. I don't know if this is going to work out or not. I don't care what other people think about it. You're not showing your face. You're not talking on your channel. It's all right. You like it, watch it. You like it, great. It's all right. Don't stress yourself.
That's actually very, very good takeaways. Thank you, Garima. It has been such an enjoyable chat. And that recipe that
you have become my new favorite. I have to come to Bombay and meet you. And feed you some vegetarian Korean food.
I would love that. And I will feed you Maharashtrian and Punjabi food. So we will do that when you're in the city next. Thank you for thank you so much for being a part of the Dare Act Conversation series. Trying to empower people in the best way possible through your, you know, own story sharing. We hugely appreciate it. And we hope that you continue to inspire many others and that your venture is as successful as you hope for it to be. Thank you, guys.
being here. Thank you for having me.
Likewise.
Have a good day to
you. You too. Bye. Thanks, everyone. Bye. Enjoy your weekend. Bye, guys.